I know that most of the people in the metropolitan area have no earthly idea what's going on in the farm, and that you can't educate all of them. There's no way you can do it. Get out and see what's going on. If they have to stand in line, like the people in Poland, to get their food, it's too late. I think there's big problems all the way up the line, and what worries me is they're not getting any better. They're multiplying. Now, how are you going to solve them? I do not know. I don't think anybody else knows, but I don't think anybody's really making the effort to try to solve them. They're more interested in building an atomic bomb or a battleship or something that doesn't pertain to the livelihood of the American people.
Not his ear to any bell which upon any occasion rings, but who can remove it from that bell which is passing a piece of himself out of this world? No man is an island entire of itself. Every man is a piece of the continent, a part of the main. Therefore, never send to know for whom the bell tolls. It tolls for thee. County, Alabama, prime farmland bordering on the Black Belt. These fields were carved from the hardwood forests that once covered the region. Long before the union of the states, before the settlers came, before cotton grew, this land provided. Indians thrived here and grew crops, beginning the long green farming history of the place. When they departed, they took nothing with them and left very little behind. The land and the water remained, with Indian names their only heritage. Generations of people have lived here and farmed this land. The planters lived here, the herdsmen, the self-sufficient farmers of the antebellum period lived here, and later the tenant farmers. Of the children of the past farming generations, few stayed to work this land, and those who did are living a small variety of rapidly dying dreams. These are the children.
Yusuf, when I first started farming, I was farming with mules, with turn plows, and Now you got tractors and you don't walk and do nothing harder but get off the tractor and go home and get dinner. You don't walk no more farming. You do it all by machine and gathering crop the same way. Pulling corn the same way. You got machine and pull corn. All of it is something looked like way back when I first started off, looked like a dream now.
Sure, I lived in days when they had the old horse and buggy. And then I remember when we had about the first planes that would fly, when everybody'd run out and jump up on the fence to see what was passing over. And since that time, we've gone a long way. Everything's changed. We've gone from the mule to the implement.
When I was a young boy from the early 30s through World War II, farming was a different era altogether from what it is now. We had several different types of farm sizes of farms in this area at that time. We had some large landowners, and then you had medium-sized landowners, and then you had small landowners with 40 acres of land or less. There was a lot of hand labor involved, and most of the work was by mules. There were a few tractors in that time, but not too many.
I went to steel mill, worked there, and after, then I went to the Army. And I was so glad to get out the Army and home, and I came home with my father, and we started farming. Mm-hmm. Some days, years, we put it good, and some years, well, we made it, put it fair. My daddy before me, he always looked out for us, be able to buy some law, buy some land, you know, have a little some work, some place to work.
Your father, what was that transition? What was the change like from what he saw when he started to what you saw when you started?
Well, that'd be difficult for me to answer, I guess. Of course, I'm sure that when he started, the excitement and the challenge was not there, and he probably looked at it from a relatively small scale of working 25 or 30 acres with two mules. And when we came, the mechanization thing had come along. Tractors were here, and we could just foresee that we could just farm the world. So I think it was much more exciting concept than what he might have had when he was working. I suppose, too, by that time, maybe that we had gotten to the thinking in terms that a farmer could make money back during the Depression. And when I was growing up as a kid, that you just thought, well, that's just a way to survive, and that's about all you can ever do. You never can accumulate anything. But then begin to think that if we're smart enough and work hard enough, that we can make money and accumulate things too. So.
The W.J. Chandler and Sons Farm is one of the largest farms in Hale County. Buster and Billy Chandler and their father Walter have spent their lives making it so. But these are not the best of times in agriculture, and all of their work has not been able to maintain the success they once enjoyed. The Chandlers are an economic pillar of their community. Buster is one of the prominent businessmen in Hale County and the mayor of his town.
Well, in our particular case, we think that we are about as diversified as a farm operation could get, and up. Well, even through now, that's supposed to be the magic word. If you're diversified, then you got a better chance of making money than you have if you stick to one crop. I'm of the opinion now that maybe that's the wrong way to do it. Sometimes if you diversify and you grow a number of crops, that one of them is going to fail every year. So you're not going to ever have a real good year. And if you concentrated on one crop, you might lose it all one year, but you'd make it next year. But at any rate, we've got a dairy operation, and we've got a beef cattle operation, and we operate a feed mill and a cotton gin and a fertilizer business. And I was talking to my wife last night, and I said, well, if things were going like they should be going with the amount of money that we've got invested, the amount of money that we spend to operate, that we ought to net $50,000 off the gin and feed mill operation. We ought to net $50,000 off of the dairy operation.
and we ought to net $150,000 or better off 2,000 acres of row crop. So that if those kind of profits were available, then we could make money. But as it is, we're not making money on any of them because of high production. Deer prices are good, milk prices are excellent, but our production costs run so high, so we're still not making any money there. Young farmer today is just behind the eight ball as far as being able to get into farming for a number of reasons. It's difficult for him to buy land in the first place because he can't finance land and pay for it. His debt service gets too high. But it's so awfully expensive now to buy equipment. The tractors and the various related piece of equipment he'd have to have. It's just young farmers, unless he has some kind of inheritance or something to give him some kind of base to operate from. Can't go out and just walk up to a tractor dealer and buy a $50,000 tractor. I think that in Buster Hartley's case, the young man that we know here, he may be gaining a foothold by some method, but those people are few and far between because they can't get the financing to get started.
I started on my own about 5 years ago. I was raised on a farm, and when I finished high school, I worked in a factory about 6 years, and the factory closed down, and I got another job, worked a year and a half, and it, they laid off a bunch of people, so I decided to go into farming on my own. Well, I worked for another fella for a couple of years, helped him farm, got a little experience of the modern experience, because it had been about 12, 15 years since I had farmed. And so I worked with him a couple of years, then I started on my own, started out kind of small, and just kind of worked my way up from there. And like I said, I've been in it about 4 years now on my own, and I've been kind of increasing a little bit every year, but after this year, after last year, I'm not going to raise any more beans. I'm just going to food with cattle. That's all I'm gonna fool with, because I can't make any money fooling with beans. And so far I have made a little fooling with cattle.
The modern experience is the management of finances, machines, and chemicals, rather than of earth, plants, and animals. It means a distance from the basics. It means a struggle to maintain that foothold. Young Buster Hartley knows that farmers are in trouble. He has watched many around him fail. He reads the papers, and his own farm is endangered by the escalating costs of everything he needs to produce food, while the prices he receives for his commodities continue to drop. In a final effort to overcome his economic problems, Buster Hartley has concentrated his resources in cows. Buster needs to prepare a piece of scrubland for pasture. He must disc it, fence it, and plant grass before the fall. He will then be ready to start his new herd.
The problem is deeper, far greater than one individual farmer who might be having financial difficulties. Due to inflation or whatever the reason. You have social problems, you have economic problems, you have political problems in a small area, a small town like this. What are we going to do with the land that isn't going to be farmed? What are we going to do with the people who are now farming the land?
We are in a situation now that really has me buffaloed. I don't know of any other way to put it, because we are looking at another change, and what we are going to change to, I do not know. However, it's very apparent that we can't continue from an economic standpoint to farm in this area as we've done in the past, as we've done the last 20 or 25 years. The economics and the bottom line will just not let us continue as we have been going. And the sad part about it is that I don't know what the answer is, and I don't know where we're going from here.
Mm-hmm. The whole thing about farming was economics. People love to farm, but they just exist. We farm to kill the hunger pains, as they didn't. You couldn't find anything to do. People couldn't do anything else after everything was closed down. Then after World War II, B.F. Goodrich came to Tuscaloosa and opened up Central Foundry, hired a lot of people. Partlow and Bryce hired just any number of people from this area. The state started hiring people to cut the right-of-ways when they stopped the prisoners from working on the highways. That took a lot of the tenant farmers out. They could make more money. That was the answer to the whole thing. They could make money. A few landowners took over then. Big farmers took over because they had machinery come in that could pick the cotton, combine together the grain, chemicals that you didn't have to have anybody to hold with.
In 1970, July the 18th, my father fell dead over the other market. He was unloading peaches, this lady. And the same day, within the same hour that this year I was unloading, and was selling the same price it was in 1970. That's 11 years.
And the price of everything that you go in to put in?
Oh, yeah. Well, you know what gas has done, fuel has done, pesticides is. They have more than tripled. 11 years ago, baskets was probably 15 cents. Now they're 40 cents. You take those peaches out, I've got 40 cents in them baskets, just in containers. I've got a quarter in them getting them picked, a quarter in getting them hauled out of the field, loaded on the truck, and it cost me a quarter to get them down here. So I've got $1.15 in picking my baskets and hauling them to Birmingham. Much less the rest of what I do.
And somebody was complaining about how much they cost?
Yeah.
You can't just pick a person up off of the street somewhere because he and do the work, because he doesn't know there's got to be some skill to it. You've just got to work on the farm. The labor that I've got has been raised here on the farm. And they're having to do something on the side to help them out, because it's not a year-round job. Although it's something to do every day, it's not a most continuous paying job.
The change in this area from agriculture to agribusiness altered the economics of farming for everyone, even for those who never sought to get bigger, who never found themselves caught up in the American dream of bigger is better. Now the economic breakdown of agribusiness threatens the complete disintegration of the tradition of farming as a way of life. Farm labor, once the occupation of everyone who lived here, is now scarce and often too expensive for the small farmer to hire. For small farmers, like Mrs. Randolph with her peach orchard, the changes wrought by the developments of agribusiness threaten to render her obsolete, to number the days of her old rural values and her self-sufficient way of life.
I don't know where. You ought to really carry your pictures and put it up here to have them sanitized, honey.
I'll pay you
for them, and then you get some more.
And if we don't have a dissatisfied customer, we see to it that he's satisfied.
Yes, sir.
If he gets a bad basket, he gets another.
Well, What do y'all find so appealing about living out on a farm? I know a lot of people...
You have to come out there and see. It's quiet, and it's so restful and so peaceful out there. And I sell my peaches in a way that at night I don't have any faces crossing my pathway when I'm trying to go to sleep. I do my best for my customers. And if they're happy, that makes me happy.
A woman determined to keep her peach orchard viable as a business against all the odds. In a crowded city suburb, in the shadow of a supermarket, she sells her fresh peaches from a truck.
And that's one way I make it, is because my children have spent all their vacations this year helping me. And we didn't count that as expense because they didn't charge me anything.
We spend our vacations and our weekends and all of that trying to help to carry on with the peach orchard. My family has a great love for the peach orchard, but it's not really very profitable.
What I'm fighting for is survival here. I hope to keep it looking as much so like as I can, like it was when my husband passed away. I come out here and mess around with these chickens two and three times a day sometimes if I have nothing else to do, because I kind of like to tend to the chickens. And if I scare them, I can't do anything with them. I have to, they come pouring out of the house. I face them up at night because of other things that lead them up. Possums, polecats, minks. They'll come and go in and destroy them at night if we don't keep them facing up. But that's just a little good part of farm life, is getting to go out and gather the eggs and feed the chickens.
The Israeli cabinet held an emergency.
They know what you like.
Hello, everybody. Good morning. Good to have you with us here on our Wednesday broadcast on the Farm and Ranch Radio Network. And the news highlights today, the USDA Secretary John Block has announced the opening of the Farmer Hell Reserve program for the 1981 crop. Farmers with 1980 crop corn, sorghum, and barley currently under the regular Commodity Credit Corporation price support loan may enter grain immediately into the Farmer Hell Reserve.
And yesterday, the Chicago soybean futures market closed slightly higher. November was 668 and a quarter, up 3.5 cents a bushel. January 688 and a half, up three. In March, up a couple of cents at 708 and three quarters. The corn futures were a little higher. December corn 297 and a quarter, up 2.5. March corn up 2.25, closing 315. Prices in the wheat futures were higher. December wheat 429 and a half, up almost two. March wheat up 2 cents a bushel, 456 and a quarter.
Our markets fluctuated mainly the part of the day yesterday because of the situation in Egypt. The gold market went up and down all day long. The futures settled $16 to $18 higher. And what the trade said was reaction to the assassination of the Egyptian President Anwar Sadat. Gold was the first to react to that assassination, moving to the $20 limit. Initial denials by the Egyptian government that Sadat had died caused prices to drop off the highs. And then there was never enough momentum to carry them higher again, despite confirmation of his death.
In what ways have you seen the farming change?
Well, it changed what I can see. People used to farm on all these hills around here. People used to work, but today, I don't know what happened, but they don't work anymore. Mm-hmm. Just about a few people work. Those out there trying to work, they'll laugh at them, honey, we working so hard for.
Mm-hmm.
But when I want $100, I don't have to go to a dam. I know they're going to get lumber or anything. I have to work for it. I think every person should work.
What do you think,
want anything.
What do you think's caused this change?
Well, in the farming?
Yeah.
Oh, well, the little farmer, I don't think, look like the little farmer just about done going out of business.
Mm-hmm.
He can't operate. I mean, machines and things is high, and of course, I believe they could do a little better if they would go to work, and if they want something, you have to work for it. You know, I don't think, the little farmer, he just done give up.
Mm-hmm.
And just a mighty few people want a farm. I think it's good money. I cheer the people would be interested in trying to farm. It's good money here. I know it's money here. And they'd be helping themselves. Next, first thing, they'd be helping themselves.
Leo Burrows cultivates several hundred acres of row crops, mostly by hand. He grows potatoes, collards, tomatoes, beans, sugarcane, and other things without any chemicals and only a few small machines. He sells through local stores, farmers markets, and off the back of his truck. People from nearby come to pick their own. It is hard, steady work, and he likes it.
Put it back up to about seven gallons. I really kind of shooting for a little less now, but I'm gonna go with that. I think I want a lot of coverage anyway. That means you're gonna be putting out about 20 gallon total spray. We're gonna be shooting for a pint and a half of bass green. So 160 gallons, you're going over about 8 acres. Add 1.5 pint. We have pint, 6 quarts. We'll try that at 6 quarts, and 8 times 3 would be 24 ounces of 240B.
You get big for two reasons. One reason is trying to make more money. And that's American way of life. The second reason is you get in a trap, which is what most farmers do. They've got a lot of money invested. Half their life they've been working at this business. And when they get in a trap of owing a big debt service, they've got to figure out how to get out of it. And the only way you can get out of it is making more money. So if you want to make more money and you're not getting as much for it, why you try to work more land? This creates more surplus and more problems.
King cotton, once the staple crop of this region, supported generations of free black and white farmers, as well as less fortunate sharecroppers. It was the economic base of the legendary Southern plantations. Now, only substantial farmers like Chandler and Sons can afford to grow cotton. It is a crop which represents the modern farming experience. Less a relationship to the land, more a manipulation of the technology upon which the growing of cotton is now totally dependent. This cotton, the foundation of the Chandler agribusiness operation, has now become so expensive to produce that they are unable to sell it at a profit. Soybeans, like cotton, are an agribusiness crop. For years, soybeans were promoted as a miracle crop, a high profit maker, because of their easy accommodation to large-scale mechanical and chemical methods. And like cotton, soybeans became a losing proposition when the cost of the technology and machinery required to produce them skyrocketed. Besides getting his pasture ready for fall, Buster Hartley must harvest his final soybean crop. At current prices, he will recoup far less than he spent to produce them. He does not work for gain, but to reduce his losses.
Be able to flop halfway up and down between the middle ways and the top low up there. I'm talking about not down up. Supposed to be able to pull it halfway up.
Like the Chandlers, Buster Hartley often finds himself at the mercy of mechanization. The machinery itself is so complex that breakdowns are frequent. And without the presence of a full-time maintenance crew, valuable hours of each farmer's day must be spent on equipment repair.
Before you close it, would you tell us, what did it turn out to be?
I don't know for sure. I just hope it was this belt that was slipping, causing a problem, but it did it again a while ago. And we don't know where it was just loose or because it was running sideways here or what. I hope it's going to solve the problem.
Tell us about the cost.
Yeah, the cost on it was $115.
Just for that belt?
For that one belt. Plus driving 40 miles after.
Before I started off farming, with a old white fella working crop on hay from Flying Mules. And the old white man, the old mule was such a plug, he used to make a wild whoop and tell us, catch him up, make him go. We used to plow and farm by night. Go to the field by light and stay in the field till they get night, just about.
This thing, that's a mold bolt. And the other thing at the point, that's the point of the thing for do the cutting the brown. One, the point cuts it, and the mold bolt turns it. You make the rope. We had to put in, start at 6 and stop at 12 for 1 hour. And go back at 1 and work till 6 again. That's the kind of hour we had to work with that plow. Sometimes, if your mule ain't too good, you had to stop before then because he'd give out. And you give out, he just won't pull no more. Better take him out and go feed him. That's. You walk behind that all day,
You'll be tired when night comes. You'll rest.
You know Mr. Allen?
Oh, yeah, that's my brother-in-law.
Mr. Allen's your brother-in-law?
That's right, he married my sister.
Did you used to work with him?
No, we used to work side and side. I used to work this farm over here. Across the road here. I was renting that farm. And he bought this farm over here, and this is the first time I had a chance to help him. In the hay field, and he ain't farming no cotton.
Mm-hmm.
He's just farming corn and raising cattle.
Mr. Fred Allen. He is on Social Security and farms out of habit, even though the glory years of agriculture in his area are over. Farming for him is a lifestyle, not a job. He can remember the good times and the bad, the era that has passed in Southern agriculture.
He made a dub out of it, didn't he? You'll get messed up raking that stuff if you don't watch yourself.
I wouldn't recommend farming to the young people now because I don't believe they would have interest in farming. Too slow for them.
All right, ease on. You got a man
farming, you know, you don't get the money. If you get in it at all, you don't get it but once a year, and that in the fall. And these young folks now, they want their money every 2 weeks or every week.
Tell us about, you said you were farming before?
Well, yeah, I farmed up high as about 200 acres.
Uh-huh.
And cotton and corn and vegetables and stuff like that.
Well, I'm ahead and cook you some water. I'll be back.
Labor got complicated, and that cut us all down, look like. I was renting most of the land that I was farming, including my own. And still, I done good at it till about 3 years ago, and I retired.
Is that because of labor? Cost of labor?
Labor shortage was the most of it. And the labor left and went off and got scattered, and there weren't enough folk to operate it. That cut it short. And I retired. I was old enough to retire. Then I retired, got on Social Security.
So the small farmers pretty well got cut out about 3 or 4 years ago.
Yeah, about 3 or 4 years ago, a lot of them got cut out. Sold equipment and stuff like that out.
Well, how do you feel about that, especially thinking about younger people wanting to get in farming? How's that make you feel?
Oh, I feel like it's going to be a few of them. Not going to be a whole lot of them like it used to be because the equipment is so high, you can't make your payment. That's what makes it complicated. And if you own that own farm, it costs so much, it's gonna take a whole lot to get set up in it.
Putting a fence up around this place here I just bought. I just purchased a couple of weeks ago and trying to get it fenced up by fall of the year so I can get some cattle in here.
It's not the matter of me I have to plow that mule, but the exercise I get up behind that mule, and I feel good plowing that mule.
Part of the old farming experience was a relationship between man and the land, between man and the animals.
The thing was tough then, you know. I didn't have much advancing, you know, to give me the time, and I just put that old tractor down on the shed and plowed the mule, and I made about 20 bales of cotton.
Tell us what happened just now.
What happened to him, he got over that blank. I think his one eyesight is going bad. Uh-huh. And he couldn't see good. He's got that bank down there. And he let us survive down in there. He's just old.
How long have you had this mule?
I had this mule, well, that's several years. He was old when I bought him. He's wore out when I bought him. But I've been getting pretty good, you know, results out of him, work out of him. And I just keep him now and trying to take care of him as best as I can. And what he eat, I just let him eat that. He can't eat nothing much but ground feed. And no grain in there. He just old. Just somebody older than I am, just about. And I know I've been here a pretty good while. So,
Looks like a nice mule.
But he lucky. See that bag, if you off that bag, skill that bag, he lucky. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir. Where are you? Yes, sir, he lucky mule. They haven't been but a few years put this potato out. And it's one of the best potatoes on. This produce man said it's the best potato on the market. But a lot of people don't know about this potato. It's a nice potato and it has a good shape to it. And it gives you a good ear too. It gives you a good ear. This dry weather here now. And if it make like this a dry weather, if you get the season, I don't know what it'll make. Now this is dry weather here now. Sure will. You know, it's time, I think, to harvest them because they'll start sprouting on the field on them. They said wait till the frost come the big sweet potatoes, but if you wait till the frost, maybe I'll run a little late. You know. And it's sweet. It's a sweet. It's about one of the best potatoes you can put in your mouth. How's that?
Why do you do it if there's not that much money in it?
Well, I mean, this year.
Uh-huh.
This year, every year don't be a lag.
Uh-huh.
See, well, some years you're going to make it, and some years if you do come out even, you're lucky.
Uh-huh.
And there's some years when you do pretty good. Take a year when the drive hits you, there ain't nothing you can do. But just take it easy and do the best thing you can and try to hope another year will be a little better. But sometimes you find out you have 2 years together, then it hurts you.
2 bad years?
It'll hurt you. 2 years together will hurt you. Okay. Take last year, we had a bad drive last year, and this year the same way.
Mm-hmm.
Well, a small man like me, he ain't got too much to lose because I don't buy them high-priced machines.
Mm-hmm.
You buy those high-priced machines, it takes money, and it takes a good crop, a yield of crop, to pay for them. The mines, I don't have much expenses. I try to do it myself.
Because I'm the fellow that fools with the finances and make out the cash flows, and I deal with the bank, and I know what the debt service is, and our situation has continued to get worse. Some of it is due to the fact that we've had 5 or 6 bad crop years in a row, but we're just faced with high production cost and variable production, and I don't believe that we can continue to operate under those circumstances that high interest rates and high production cost and are going to drive us out of business. I'll be very much surprised if we are in business next year.
Is an important historical symbol of the modernization of agriculture. Back when the dream of large and efficient farms seemed to be coming true, W.J. Chandler and Sons Cotton Gin ran 24 hours a day. Its operation provided jobs for many people. Now, the increasingly idle gin is a symbol of the breakdown of the economics of scale. The small farmer of cotton gave way to the large-scale producer of cotton. Soon, the agribusinessmen will give way to the future, pushed out by the expense and complications of the very technology they thought would ensure their economic survival.
I think our situation is so that we're saying that we are faced with the prospect of selling some real estate and it's farmland, and I think if we do have to do that, that it will not sell to another farmer, that the farmer, if he's actually going to get out there and work that land and try to produce off it, that he can't afford to pay the price that that land will sell for and farm it and pay for it. So it boils down to the fact that the land is not going to be owned by the farmers in the first place. It's going to wind up being owned by somebody else.
Your land really expensive now to what it used to be, you know. My board here is real cheap. But now, they tell me, good Lord don't make no more land. That's the reason it's so high. I reckon that's about true. I ain't here till it made no more. And fellas just got to have a good credit, a lot of money to buy land now. I reckon about 10 times what it used to be. Yeah. I bought this, it was real cheap. 6 acres of land for $2,400. And I think you can't hardly get an acre now for this. In certain places, you had to pay more in that food.
An enormous amount of land is developed and paved every year across the United States. In 50 years, we have paved over the equivalent of all the cropland in Ohio. Before the century is out, we will pave over an area the size of Indiana. This is land that used to belong to Buster Chandler and Buster Hartley and the others. 20 years ago, this land in Tuscaloosa, Alabama, was producing crops.
don't know, farming. Farming look like now that's playing out to me. It seems like to me it, and a few more years, it won't be nothing but the big man showing up farming. Because the little man, he just won't be able to do it. It's done changed a whole lot since I've been big enough to know it. Yeah.
Do you think that's a bad thing?
Well, I think it's a bad thing because everything we eat comes off some farm somewhere. Somebody got to farm and produce something for us to have something. Mm-hmm. And I don't know. I in a few more years, I don't think money will get you what you want because you can't buy a thing when ain't nobody producing it.
Well, it boils down to the fact that the people that are doing it are going to have to be able to make money. If they're not, whether they like it or not, they're going to get out of the business. And when you get farmers out of the business and you begin to have shortages, then prices are going to go higher, and you're going to be in real trouble. I think the Polish situation is a good point in this respect, that when you get food shortages, you get high prices, and that's the thing you don't want.
What's the situation with your beans this year?
Well, we're almost through, and looks like we're going to average maybe 15, 16 bushel overall. We like about 15 acres being through with mine, and that looks like about what we're going to average.
What kind of money are you getting for them this year?
They're about $6.20 right now. I don't look for them to get much better.
What should it be? How much does it cost you to make them?
Well, you would kind of have to figure it like you'd have to average 20 bushel to the acre and get probably $7 a bushel for them to break even. So that goes to show you there ain't no profit made in beans this year.
The future, of course, is unknown. Faith in a better day to come has always made uncertainty more bearable. But faith seems elusive to this generation of farmers. The depletion of natural resources and loss of prime farmland to neglect and commercial exploitation is only one aspect of the dilemma for future generations. We have seen the loss here of human resources. As we have adjusted to the depersonalization of modern life, we must ask ourselves, how far can it go? Man, a little man, can farm no longer. When these individuals pass, they will leave no heirs to carry on the tradition. So the question becomes, by whom or by what means will the food and fiber for our children be grown?
I do it because that's my occupation. I'm raised up doing this. Mm-hmm. I don't know nothing else to do but this. That's what I've been doing all my life up until this time. Mm-hmm. That's why I do it. If I stop doing this, I have to be sick and can't get about. I'd be lost, look like.
Being able to do what I want to do. And back when we had a little time when we could hunt and fish and that kind of thing, I thought that farming was probably an ideal life, and I still think it is. I enjoy it. I guess one of the things that complicated for us is the fact that we've had bad weather for several years. Now, if weather had been good and we'd been making good crop, we wouldn't be crying quite so bad. But I enjoy it. I mean, I wouldn't get up and work 13 hours a day doing something I didn't like to do. You just couldn't stand that kind of thing.
In the future that the farming situation is going to get better. It's going to have to for us to keep operating.
I'm going to try to stick it out another year or two to hang on. I'm cutting my operations down. I'm changing things up to try and do better to make ends meet is the biggest thing. And I feel like that maybe in a year or two, people in Washington is going to realize that they've got to do something to help the farmers out. If not, somebody's going to get hungry. And I want to stay on the farm. I want my kids to be on the farm because I just think it's a better life than it is raising up in a factory or city or something like that. I just feel like they should be outside. I know I like to be outside. I don't like to be closed up. And that's where I want my family is on the farm. But if things don't change within the next 2 years, I won't have any choice but to probably sell out and find a job somewhere like everybody else is doing or having to do. I know a few of my neighbors are having to do it. So I just hope things get better in the next couple of years. They're going to have to in order for us to keep operating. I just hope things get better. That's all we can look forward to, is just try to hang in there and do the best we can right now and to get by and survive.